The biggest icon in wrestling.
Welcome back, week five of the AD and Coach P podcast. So happy to be here with everyone. My name's Nick Gill. I'm the athletic director at Mercy High School. Sitting across from me is the assistant athletic director, the varsity basketball coach, the varsity golf coach, the man himself, Coach P. Coach, how we doing today?
Doing great. Baseball is back. Opening day in Boston for our beloved Orioles, 2:10, first pitch.
Love it. So at the time we're recording this, we're about 2 hours away from first pitch. I know everyone who follows the Orioles, like myself and Coach P, is very excited for today. We've been waiting for today for a long time, especially because it gives us a break from the consistent negative news we always hear about the Ravens right now. So but switching it up today, we have a special podcast. So our guest on the show today is a longtime friend of mine. He is the associate athletic director.
Assistant
athletic director at Friends School of Baltimore. Ken Zalis, better known as KZ. So Ken has a wealth of knowledge when it comes to Baltimore sports in general, from professional sports to college sports, to the high school sports scene in Baltimore. He's somebody that you would want to turn to if you want to know anything about Baltimore sports. So he's also retired nationally renowned fantasy football analyst. Are you still retired?
For right now, yes.
So he's still retired, but he's helped me win many fantasy football championships over the years by and me annoying him on week to week asking for his advice. And since it's opening day today, we thought it would be great to have Ken on the show. So Ken, welcome to the AD and Coach P podcast.
I feel like I'm supposed to start with, let me tell you something, brother. but I won't. But I appreciate you guys having me. This is really, really cool, and I've enjoyed listening to the two of you and what you've done so far. It's a really cool idea, probably one I'll steal at some point, like I stole everything else. but you're used to that.
Well, I know you've done a million of these, so it's great to have you on with us and be able to spend some time and just talk sports with us. And Ken and I go way back to my Friends School of Baltimore days. So for those who don't know, I worked at Friends School of Baltimore for 8 years before coming to Mercy and taking the AD job. And I've now been at Mercy for 9 years. So Ken and I have been friends for quite a while. Ken, can you give everybody a little background on yourself and kind of like the KZ origin story?
Well, I don't know how far back you want to go. Born and raised in Baltimore, went to Randallstown High School. You have to say where you went to high school when you're talking mm-hmm. Baltimore sports. Nobody cares where you went to college. The way I came to Friends was sort of through my son. My son, who will be graduating this year, started at Friends in 2008. And the kind of funny story, the way he wound up at Friends, I used to be a youth advisor for about 12 to 15 years. And I had kids from private, public, all kinds of schools. And the kids I had from Friends were just, God, they were nice kids, and they were well-rounded, and mm-hmm. they just didn't care about one thing, and they came and let us in community service stuff, they let us in religious stuff, and they let us in sports activities, and I was like, I don't know, didn't even have a kid at that time. It's like, but if I ever had one, and they wound up at a private school, I wanted to go to Friends. So when it came time to do that, and circumstances dictated, we look at private schools, I only looked at Friends, and great decision for my family and for Jonah. And the story goes that my current boss, the AD over at Friends, is Kara Carlin. Her husband, Josh, has been mm-hmm. a longtime teacher and administrator there. My wife heard Josh talking just in general, not to her, that they were looking for a softball coach at Friends. And at the time, I had my own private business, so my schedule was pretty good. Right. She's like, why don't you go do that and get out of the house? And so I did it, and now I'm going into my 15th or 16th year, and now Josh's wife, Kara, is my boss. So yeah. It's just how it all kind of connected through the ways. And, you know, at Friends, I've been the varsity girls basketball coach for about 7 years. I've been the varsity softball coach for 15 years. I was involved in JV, middle school, JV, varsity soccer for, I don't know, 12 of my years there.
Yeah.
So I've done just about everything, always on the girls' side there, which was just kind of how it happened. And, outside, you're very kind, but if you recognize my voice or recognize KZ, it's probably from either fantasy football writing. I was a national writer for fantasy football and the NFL draft in the last 7 years, probably exclusively for Pressbox and Pressbox Online.
Right.
So that's me.
Yeah. And and Ken and I can't remember when we first met. I know obviously it was through you working in the athletic department. And I was probably working in admission at that time, but I was coaching the varsity girls soccer team, and you were brought in at some point to work. I can't remember how it happened.
I don't know how it happened. So the first year I was there, I did softball in the spring, mm-hmm. and then they kind of said, well, what else can you do? And I was like, well, I'm kind of a soccer guy. I go, well, great. And they threw me, and they gave me this middle school B girl soccer team.
Right.
And I remember I was like, well, this is pretty cool. I think we're better than the A team. and then I don't know if I did 1 or 2 years from that. And then, took the JV and you were the varsity coach and we worked really well together. And
yeah, that's,
I don't know how great of a soccer coach I was, but I was always a really good talent evaluator.
Absolutely.
And I understood where kids' best positions were on the field, mm-hmm. And where they should be playing. And that, you know, I probably did JV for what? I don't know, 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
I don't.
I mean, as long as I did the varsity, I remember you doing the JV.
I mean, I was there. I mean, at least through 14.
Yes.
Through the championship year, because you brought a bunch of my girls and brought me through the playoff run up.
Right.
And then, you know, when you left and through the other coaches, I think I did one more year of JV because Richie Seiler. Was the
shout out to Rich Seiler.
Shout out to Rich Seiler, who was the bridge to the next varsity coach, and then I just became part of the varsity staff and did that. And so, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I was fortunate enough to be the varsity girls soccer coach at Friends for 5 years, maybe 4 or 5 years. So I was able to work with Ken and the great thing that I remember that was so nice to work with Ken is he worked in the building. So yes. I could come sit in his office and we could talk about soccer and talk about game plans or, you know, who we see coming through the program. And you did such a great job of bringing kids through the JV program and making sure they stuck with it and eventually played varsity. And I remember you would always tell me, you know, you have a kid, you know, she's, might not be varsity next year, but her junior year, she's going to come and help. And I'd be like, oh, okay, Ken, we'll see. Yeah. And then, you know, the one that comes to mind is Maria Park, and now then we get her as a junior, she's scoring game winners against Bryn Mawr. And that's something that'll always stick with me. And I think I agree with you. You're a great, great evaluator of talent and you knew how to get the best of the kids. And I miss those days, miss working with you.
Yeah, no, we always had a good time and, you know, we always had we were fortunate. And, you know, I know you always feel fortunate. I mean, I always say, you know, coaches are fantastic, but if you don't have players,
mm-hmm.
you know, we can be the greatest coach in the world. If you don't have players, I mean, you'll do the best by them.
Yep.
Really fortunate, especially during that time frame. We just had tremendous student athletes at that time mm-hmm. that came through the program and elevated for what was a, honestly, we're kind of rebuilding at Friends now in the girls soccer program and just made a great new hire that we're very excited that. About.
Yeah.
Marcelo Robinson, who very acclaimed, plays for Puerto Rican national team and things like that.
Impressive.
I think she's going to be fantastic as a high school coach. But we're kind of, we're rebuilding that.
Mm-hmm.
But, during your time and even for about 6 years after you, mm-hmm. We had a good, 12-year run where girls soccer at Friends was really, really good.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. So we have always do when we have a student athlete on three questions
okay.
for our guests from Coach P. We've changed them a little bit today. So Coach P, I'm going to kick it over to you. Let's give Ken our three questions from Coach P. Go ahead, Coach.
Okay, Ken. Question one, what is your favorite memory as a high school coach?
There are so many of them, and it's easy to always go back to championships.
Mm-hmm. You can give top three if you need to.
I don't think so. And for me, my greatest high school memory doesn't have anything to do with me. Okay. It has to do with my son who. Mm-hmm. And this is probably kind of weird, but I mean, he's a soccer kid. He's going to go play goalie for Sarah Lawrence College next year.
Awesome.
And but his first game as a varsity goalie starter, he got brought up at the end of his freshman year to the varsity team, but circumstances. Because of COVID, we missed a year, but his junior year, he came in and they had a varsity goalie who started and got hurt very early. So the first league game, my son starting and he had a shutout. That is my greatest high school memory.
That's awesome.
And he was fantastic that day. And his club teammate, was on that team and he scored the two goals and it was just
very cool.
It was just a really cool moment and that's probably it. I mean, softball, look, we've won two championships over the past 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Last year we got moved up from C to B. It was probably one of my most enjoyable years. I mean,
yeah.
It's even better. And we didn't win the championship. We lost in the semifinals, but we only lost to you all and, mm-hmm. and the Catholic last year. And we had a really,
I think you really, really exceeded really expectations.
I'm the first to admit I fought. I didn't want to go. I didn't think we were, I thought we were a year away from being ready because just the pitching in B is just so much different than it was in C. I mean, we were getting mm-hmm. slow pitch softball. Is what it is. But I was so proud of them. And from an overall standpoint, I'm really long-winded. You'll have to get used to that.
That's okay.
So if you do,
we got all the time.
If you do
world.
A 15-minute podcast, it's probably 25 with me. But that was my most rewarding season
very cool.
as a coach. Just how they overachieved and how they came together as a team. They really loved playing for each other. And they cared. I mean, mm-hmm. and they wanted to do well. Even some of the kids that didn't play a whole lot, and that's the one thing about Friends, and especially in the softball program, that I'm very proud of building. It's like we would take anybody, and we would never cut, and we still won't. I mean, I got 20 kids this year, and quite frankly, I don't know that six of them would be on any other softball team in the B conference. They wouldn't even take them because mm-hmm. they I'm teaching some kids to do the basics, but that's what, to me, that's what built the program and will never change. But even those kids, they were just into the game.
That's great.
And it's so much fun to watch. It's like they're just into it. It's like they don't care that they're not going to play 1 second.
Right.
They were just into the games and every pitch and every out. And that's like an overall
coaching season. Yeah. And it's a testament of the culture you've built in your program at Friends. And, you and I talked about, I remember the conversation clearly when you got moved up from C to B and, I agreed with you. Everything you said, I was like, I don't know, man. You guys might not be ready. You know, you probably are a year away. And, you know, we had some conversations on that. But, you know, at the end of the day, it was, you know, it is what it was. Like, you had to go. And then you came in, and I think you really, really did an unbelievable coaching job last year. You were my pick for coach of the year last year. That's for sure.
I appreciate that.
Cause I don't think anybody saw Friend School coming from the C to the B and then going right to the semifinals. So impressive.
Yeah. It was a fun year. And I think what set the tone is that, you know, when it was made the decision, I brought my 2B seniors in and my 2B junior pitcher, which was the only reason that we were elevated. I mean, she's a special kid. She's going to play at Stevenson next year.
And that's the young lady who...
Molly Parker.
Who hit the ball into the gas station parking lot.
She crushed one in the scrimmage we have. It was impressive. I'm so happy you guys were able to... your parents could share that video with us, because that was just
hardest ball hit out on Heckwolf Field that I've seen since we've had that field out there. I think this is year four of that field. And... her name's Grace, you said?
Molly Parker.
Molly, I'm sorry. So yeah. Molly hit one over our home run fence that also cleared the wrought iron fence at the bottom of the hill. Into the street, bounced then into what I would assume the gas station parking lot, and then just incredibly hit ball.
Exxon got a souvenir.
Yes, they did.
Somebody got a souvenir. I mean, sitting down with her and the seniors and saying, look, they can never take away the championship we won last year, and let's just give it our all. Let's just go and see what we can do. And the attitude that they brought to it and the leadership that group brought to it, it just made all the difference in the world.
And it's tough. It's a tough jump, but you know, if the kids buy in,
I mean, and you got to have that. I mean, you've looked at watching Mercy go up in everything over the last, you know, 3-4 years, you know, from lacrosse to basketball to softball, name a sport, you've moved up. And you have to have that. And you've done well, you know, in each step along the way. So it's, you guys know more than anyone else. You know, you have to have that buy-in from your players that says, okay, well, you know, yeah, we may not win the championship this year, but let's go and compete and see what happens at the end of the day.
Yeah, agreed. All right, Coach, what we got? Question two.
Let's talk O's. Vegas has the Orioles over under at 78.5 games this year. What are your thoughts on that, over or under? And what do you think about our season?
Such a good number. Vegas is so good at this.
They are. It's crazy.
It's crazy how good they are at it. Because it's such a good number. And you would say, well, it's worse than they did last year. And it's like, well, yeah, it is. But they're bringing a lot younger, inexperienced team, forward this time. They added a couple of pieces in Gibson and Irvin to their pitching staff, but they still don't have that guy. And that guy that you're expecting to be in Rodriguez really showed, I don't know what it was this spring, but they sent him down recently. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that was, a lot of people are saying that's a, you know, they don't want to start his clock yet and things like that. And he flat out wasn't great. That's the guy that needs to be the next ace of your staff for 10 years for you to take that next step. It's funny. It goes back, you know, to the Weeders days and you know, there were certain guys that, you know, if Weeders isn't that guy, I don't know that they're that good all the time.
Right.
I kind of think we got enough of Adley. Adley's that guy.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I mean, Adley's looks like a once-in-a-lifetime Hall of Fame type player.
Yep.
You looked at the little bit that you got from Gunner last year, and you're really excited about that.
All right, that's my guy I'm most excited about.
You look at some of the other kids that I don't know if they're, you know, I didn't actually see exactly who they're bringing, but Westbrook had a great spring.
Westberg. Yeah, Westberg.
You got their former number one. I mispronounced his name. Kirchitz, or I forget what his name.
Yeah, Kerstad.
Kerstad, yeah.
Yep.
He had a great spring. And then you got Stowers, and you got Kowalczyk, and you got all these guys, Ortiz. You got all these guys that are ready to come. So there's all this excitement.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know they're on. I don't know that they're that next step. Right. So if I was a betting man, which I am a betting man, you know, I think they win 78, so I would go under.
Wow,
because it's that close.
They're going to miss it by a half.
Yeah, I think it's that close. I just think there are too many guys, especially in the bullpen, had career years last year.
Right.
It's really hard. I think Bautista is what he is. They figured him out.
The mountain.
But when you look at Barker and you look at Perez and mm-hmm. you look at these guys that came out of nowhere to have these career years, it's tough to duplicate career right. years. Nobody has them.
Right.
So I worry a little bit about the bullpen and the youth. Are they ready for that next
step? That's a good point.
I think they're going to be really, really good. Like, it's no fluke that everybody has them as the number one farm system. They are loaded.
Right.
They right. are loaded. But they need guys like Rodriguez and D.L. Hall to be ready for the major leagues, mm-hmm. I think, to take that next step. So, big Orioles fan, as you can tell, as I kind of rolled off about a half a dozen to a dozen names. But I think I think they're going to be competitive. I think they're going to be exciting. I just think they're going to take a half a step back this year.
And
sometimes you think need that
a lot
to
of
go
people
forward.
A lot of people think it's going to be right around that.
Yeah, it's a good number.
It really is.
It's a good number. I wouldn't bet it. I honestly didn't because right. a lot of people are like, oh, that's an easy. I was like, ooh, that's a good number.
It really is. And one, I mean, they had the one major injury to Means last year, but by and large, they were pretty healthy all year in terms of avoiding major injuries. I mean, that's something too. Like, you know, you don't know what's going to happen. Imagine if they were to lose Adley for a long stretch.
Stop
or something,
that. Don't
right?
even put that into the universe.
I think
put that out there.
Vegas has to take that into account. Like, is everybody going to stay healthy the entire season again?
Well, it's not, but they have some depth. I mean, look, I mean, you can't, and no team can. I mean, you look at the Padres. Padres, everybody's picking the Padres this mm-hmm. year. If they lose Manny,
right?
Well, they don't have anybody to replace Manny.
Right.
You know, you don't have guys to replace your superstars. I mean, when Trout goes out for the Angels, they don't have another guy to put in that's going to put out Trout. God forbid Ohtani gets hurt.
Right.
I mean, they don't have a pitcher or a hitter. They can, you know, right. you don't have your superstars. But what they do have is they have some depth. So if an outfielder, any outfielder goes down, okay, if any infielder goes down, you have somebody that's built in depth there.
Yeah, I agree.
Right there. But, you know, if your superstars go down, and then, you know, if Means can come back somewhere around July and give you a good.
That'd be great.
That'd be a nice lift at the midpoint of the season. Mm-hmm. So. Look, I would love to be 1,000% wrong here. And
right.
I would love to see them, you know, approach 90 and take that next step.
If they get to 90, they're getting a wild card. That'd be nice.
Yeah.
So I was just going to say, Ken, we hope you're dead wrong.
I hope I'm right. Look, I say so many things over the years that I hope I'm dead wrong about too. But it's just, you just look at it and you have to take off the Orioles hat for a moment. And just look at it from the outside and really be honest about it and say, look, you know, their biggest issue last year was starting pitching.
Right.
Did they address it? Yes, they did. Did they address it in a big way?
So they're banking on the guys they had last year taking another step.
They are, but you're also banking on, like I said, those career years that happened in the bullpen
right.
being there again. That's a tough thing when you're on paper and you're starting to predict things.
Mm-hmm.
That's a tough thing to predict that Perez, who had never done it before,
right.
and Barker, who had never done it before, are going to have those, like, just shut down 6th, 7th, and, you know, Givens coming in and is a nice thing.
Right.
But it's not like he was he's never – you always thought that he should be better than he was.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he should be dominant, and he's never been dominant. He's been good. He's a good guy to have.
Yeah.
Another good live arm.
Yep.
But it's like, I just worry a little bit about that.
Right. All right. Well, you've heard it here. Yeah. KZ is saying
KZ's
under
negative.
78.
KZ's negative.
And if if this actually falls right on 78, you know, when we get to September last year, I mean, next year, I'd be amazed that KZ predicted this on the nose. But let's go to question three.
Okay, our other team, Ken, our other team. What is going on with the Lamar Jackson saga? Is Lamar backing himself into a corner? Do the Ravens or Lamar have the leverage?
Man, this, aren't you just tired of this?
Extremely.
First of all, it's all a dance.
Mm-hmm.
And it is. It's all a dance. And here's a little bit insider-ish, a little bit outsider-ish. The insider in me is saying that this is both sides up until the last week trying to be really nice and respectful. We haven't heard, like, you never heard numbers that right. The Ravens have never come out and said anything publicly negative about Lamar. Lamar has really not ever said anything negative about the Ravens outside of the fact that they're not giving him the contract that he wants.
Right.
Okay? Who has the advantage? No one has the advantage.
Okay.
You know, if anyone has the advantage, I mean, if Lamar wants to play football next year, it's with the Ravens.
Right.
Like, nobody, like, this is a 26-year-old stud quarterback that nobody's made an offer on that's been available for 2 weeks.
Crazy.
Anybody can have him for two first-round picks. We've seen the San Francisco 49ers trade three first-round picks and half their draft for a guy that was in college.
Mm-hmm.
In Trey Lance.
Mm-hmm.
They gave away their entire world because they thought that was the guy. That's what teams do. They go and get the quarterbacks. There's nobody in this draft. Like, if you're the Carolina Panthers and you think that you're a quarterback away, would you rather have Lamar Jackson or C.J. Stroud?
Right. So then what's the holdup?
The holdup is that Lamar wants a guaranteed – he doesn't want a fully guaranteed contract. Let's not. I don't want to put that on him. He doesn't, but he wants $200 million plus guaranteed.
Okay,
some way somehow.
Right.
The Ravens offered him at this point. The Ravens offered him essentially $133 million guaranteed for 3 years.
Right.
Which a lot of people said he should have taken because then at 29 you can get another contract.
Right.
And the way this goes, the salary cap keeps on going up.
Right.
So the contracts keep on getting bigger and bigger. Now, Lamar not having a real representative is a tough thing.
Do you think that turns teams off from dealing
it
does, with
it, them? It's not that it turns them off. It just, you don't know who to call.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know who to call. This goes back, if any of you follow me on social media, I reposted something on Facebook that I wrote in 2018 about Lamar.
I saw that, actually, and
okay.
I laughed at it because it was spot on.
It was spot on.
Which is
and
crazy.
Sometimes it is. It's like, and it had to do with his draft status and with, like, I graded him in that draft year as the number two prospect coming out of college.
Mm-hmm.
I have always been high on Lamar, and there's a very famous thing on Pressbox with when the Ravens drafted him of me and Glenn Clark just screaming at each other because I'm ecstatic, and he's like, this has nothing to do with him, but what are the Ravens doing, and how are you drafting a quarterback? You have Joe Flacco. It's like it was a whole thing.
Right.
That was hilarious. It's still hilarious to this day. But, like, even back then when he was going through the process, he didn't decide to do certain drills, and certain teams were complaining because they couldn't schedule meetings with him. And
because I remember he opted out of the 40, right?
He opted out of the 40, and for a, I thought he should have ran it because
he can fly.
Because he can fly, and it would just help his draft status. Mm-hmm. As you're like, oh, wait. Because his tape was great.
Right.
I mean, all this stuff about Lamar can't.
All you got to do is look at the Louisville Clemson game from his what was that his junior year
or sophomore year? Yeah.
The Florida State game, unbelievable.
Yeah, it's just he can throw. It was never about that. It's just that he's different. He's one of one.
Mm-hmm.
But even back then, teams were complaining that they didn't know who to call and they couldn't get meetings with him.
Right.
This is not a new thing because he has represented himself all along the way. It's really difficult.
And it's counterculture to the way the NFL does business.
It does. It's crazy. Now, you know, people will point to Smith, the linebacker that they just re-signed, who doesn't have an agent. he doesn't have an agent, but he has a representative. Mm-hmm. Like the agent doesn't sign and negotiate contracts, but you know who to call to get a meeting and say, let's start talking. You don't know who to call with Lamar, so you're trying to get a hold of Lamar, and now Lamar's gone on social media.
Right.
And it's just – it seems like it's getting uglier in the nicest way between the teams. Like, nobody's still – even all of this, he's just saying this is all about money.
Right.
If the Ravens offered him this number, whatever his number is
– he'd be here.
He'd be here. And quite frankly, because nobody signed him to an offer sheet, Lamar has a choice. Sign the offer sheet and work towards a long-standing contract,
mm-hmm.
or hold out.
Right.
Now, you're doing yourself no favor by holding out because there's all – well, you know, why should other teams sign you to a contract or do an offer sheet if they don't know, like,
right.
where to go and who to do? Right. So I don't think he has any other option right now besides the Ravens. And if he wants to be traded – and, look, I want to be traded.
And he's, but he's
take,
gonna
that, have, take he, that with a grain of sand.
But to get traded, he's going to have to sign,
he has
sign
to
our
sign,
franchise
he has
agree,
to,
tag
the
anyway.
The Ravens
right?
could do nothing.
Right.
Like right now, that's why I say, you know, maybe the Ravens are a little bit have this. The Ravens have anybody who has ever wanted out of Baltimore, they have obliged.
Right.
You want out, we will find a trade partner. Right. We will make the best deal. You go back the last 5 years, any of them.
Right.
Hurst, Orlando Brown.
Yep.
Hollywood, they're all. It's right. like
Chuck Clark.
I mean, they tried to work that out, and right. then finally he's like, "Okay, well, this is the best deal."
Right?
Okay, they have worked everything else. Chuck Clark asked last year, and then mm-hmm. you know wanted again. They found they weren't going to re-sign him to what he wanted, so they found they if you don't want to be here, they don't want you. I yep. think it's one of the great things about the Ravens.
Yep.
You know, and I'm as critical as any of some of the things they do and their coach and their GM, but you don't want to be here, they'll find a trade partner. They are stuck. They put the franchise tag on you. They can do nothing.
Right.
So push comes to shove. I think it probably gets worked out, and it's going to be a long summer.
Oh, boy.
But I think he's probably the quarterback of the Ravens this year.
Okay. All right. Well,
jumped it on that one.
But. Yeah, but that's better news than we've heard from our athletes the last 4 weeks who say no way Lamar's a Raven. So I'm a big Lamar Jackson fan. I hope he's a Raven. I think the owner probably hopes this gets worked out because I believe if there's no Lamar Jackson next year, they're going to have a little ticket sale problem.
Tickets are already sold.
Oh, and
I mean,
with season, I'm wrong on that.
With season tickets, and
I just turned like down that. Somebody offered me season tickets, and I turned them down because I don't know if Lamar's going to be there. So,
you know, if Lamar somehow is not here, you're just rebuilding. I mean, and it's not a hard rebuild because you're going to get
our defense is still stacked.
Your defense is great. You're going to get if he's not here, you're getting at least two first round picks for him. So,
right.
you have some flexibility. I mean, you could. I'm not a big fan of the quarterbacks outside of CJ this year, but. You know, you could draft a quarterback and, you know, start to rebuild. I think if they do trade him, I would like them to tank and draft Caleb Williams from USC next year.
Love him. I was actually going to bring that up.
That would be the way I would do it. I know that's not in the nature of the franchise, mm-hmm. but that would be my route.
Okay. All right. Well, we got through the questions. We got to talk Orioles and Ravens. Now it's time to put KZ, Ken Zalis, on the Magic hot seat. All right, KZ, Magic hot seat, 45 seconds.
Okay.
Rapid fire question, one word answers.
That's not my strong suit, as you could just tell.
Coach P, say when.
Ready, go.
Ravens or Orioles?
Orioles.
Lacrosse or soccer?
Soccer.
Softball or basketball?
Softball.
Cool Ranch or nacho cheese Doritos?
Nacho.
Sushi or pizza?
Pizza.
Summer or winter?
Summer.
Fall or spring?
Ooh, spring.
Jordan or LeBron?
Oh, Jordan.
Lamar or Flacco?
Lamar.
Harbaugh or Billick?
Billick.
Shawn Michaels or Ric Flair?
Oh, Shawn's greatest ever.
Agreed. Cake or ice cream?
Yes.
Dunkin' or Starbucks?
I wish there was a Dunkin' by me. Dunkin'.
Thanksgiving or Halloween?
Oh, Thanksgiving.
And yes or no, and we already got a little information on how Ken feels about this, but yes or no, will Lamar Jackson be a Baltimore Raven week one of the NFL regular season?
Yes.
Yes. All right, Coach P. KZ has survived the magic hot seat. Congratulations, KZ.
That was fun.
What?
I think I did that really quickly, too.
You did.
You gave me 45 seconds. I didn't need them.
You did. That was great.
Cake or ice cream?
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
All right. Well, we always close out the show with the Magic Athletics Coach P Lock of the Week. Coach P, you've hit on every single one so far. All right. Give us your Magic Athletics Lock of the Week.
This one's a special one, okay? Saturday night, Final Four. I have a former player from Perry Hall that I coached, Anthony Walker, playing for Miami. You know, they play UConn at 8:49 Saturday night. I'm going with my boy Walker and Miami to beat UConn.
You heard it here. Coach P taught Anthony Walker everything he knows, and now is going to rely on Anthony Walker and the Miami Hurricanes to upset UConn? Would that be an upset?
It would. They're underdogs.
Yeah.
What do you think about this, KZ?
I went to Miami.
Oh, so KZ's riding with the Hurricanes.
So I'm all about it.
Let's go.
All right. All right. Well, this might be the most dicey Coach P Magic Athletics Lock of the Week, but you heard it here. If you want to ride with Coach P, you got the Miami Hurricanes and Anthony Walker beating UConn. All right, everyone. Well, thank you so much for listening to this special edition. We went longer than we have in the past, so I hope you stuck around and enjoyed this. KZ, thank you so much
for being on the show. Appreciate it.
Love to have you back one day.
Anytime.
And we won't be on next week. We'll be off for spring break, so we'll be back in 2 weeks. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you again.